Welcome to the official podcast at contentchampion.com. Join our heroic quest to discover truly epic content. Introducing your host, the content champion himself, Lost James.
Hi folks, and welcome to session 11 of the Content Champion podcast. Just a quick piece of housekeeping. Don't forget to enter your best content marketing material in the Content Champion Awards at contentchampion.com/awards. This week, I'm thrilled to be talking about viral content with Richard Marriott of Clamber.com, an engaging and inventive SEO and online entrepreneur. Richard tells us how he got nearly 2,500 social shares to one of his very first roundup posts, and details a blueprint we can all use to emulate his success. So let's get started. Thanks for coming on, Richard.
Thanks for having me today.
Now, we're going to talk about viral blog posts in this session, and you've got a great example to share with us. But before we kick off, could you tell us where we can find you online and give us your backstory on how you got started?
You can find me on clamber.com. Clamber means as in clambering up something. The name is without the E, like Tumblr or Flickr. And the blog, basically, I started it because I thought there were not enough blogs with newbies giving experience of trying to, you know, climb up on Google. Mm-hmm. And I was very much an SEO newbie back in March this year. And I wanted to just create something that would give people an experience of with case studies and kind of adventure and testing various things out to see what makes you get up on Google, which expert tutorials work, and to find out what the experts are kind of doing to make their sites get popular. The main thing it was supposed to be about is to kind of guinea pig test techniques and, you know, see what you could do with SEO to get up on Google. The reason I decided to do Clamber was because I was working for a steel trading company in Beijing.
Right.
And we were relying on Alibaba too much to get inquiries. Mm-hmm. And it was a really stupid process. And Alibaba inquiries, they're like rubbish, really. So I thought, oh, well, let's make it like a website that's really like optimized for Google so we can get all our inquiries for free. So I pitched it to my boss, bought the website, and then locked myself in a flat for 2 months, writing out the content and learning about SEO, teaching it from, there's this book, The Art of SEO. You probably know it.
Yes, indeed.
And I taught it all myself and then went back into the office 2 months later, probably 10 kilograms lighter, found a web developer, and we bashed the website up. And then I got an SEO on board, and he was really pleased with the on-site optimization. And then we just we managed to get it up into an inquiry machine just 2 months later. It was getting 70 inquiries a month, which is very good for steel.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, it got us a lot of business, and a few other Chinese websites copied us. No, but it's done great, yeah. Basically, that's how I got really into SEO, and then thought, hell, why don't I make a blog about it?
And you've done really well in the last 6 months. I mean, your site's really taken off, hasn't it?
Yes, it has, yeah. It's had a huge change, but it's only since I did an expert roundup post. Before that, it wasn't really going anywhere. So I needed to do something a little bit crazy to get some serious traffic to it.
Okay, we're going to come on to the viral post that you wrote that really sort of set a marker down for the standard of content that you were going to provide in a moment. But I do have to tell the listeners that you're actually living and working in Beijing at the moment. Could you tell us a bit about that and what it's like for businesses over there?
Yeah, sure thing, Loz. It's pretty crazy out here. I'll share a few weird things. You can get McDonald's delivered 24/7, which is wonderful because when you come home from a night out, you've always got food coming to the door. I love the kind of like a quirkiness of constant, like Chinglish, we call it.
Chinglish?
Yeah, it's like, you know, typos on signs and funny ways of saying things.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
For example, my old office, it was above a restaurant called The Chafing Dish. Yeah, constant things on menus, like dishes called The Peasant Exploded. It's great living in China. You can eat like a king every day. Motorbikes are really cheap. Chinese friends are pretty cool. I mean, I had one experience where I got in a fight one day. I had to hide in a garden outside for like 2 hours whilst these people were hunting me down. And I called my Chinese friend and he picked me up at like 4 in the morning or something. He had to come 2 hours away from the other side of Beijing. he drove me home, and then it turned out that I'd lost my key. He actually helped kick down my door to my flat so I could just get in and go to sleep.
A friend's only a true friend when they've helped you kick down your own door.
Exactly, yeah. But yeah, Chinese friends, they're awesome, and I love China in that sense. In terms of business, it's pretty crazy and very different to the UK or US, as I'm sure you know. Deals are usually won over drunken feasts.
Really?
Yeah, it's always won over some massive feast, and they'll have a lot of baijiu, which is a Chinese white wine. And some of this stuff, it can get up to like 60%. You just you drink loads of it around the table, and you have to drink with every single person around a circle table. There's this terrible train ticket website, which was made, obviously, won over a meal like this. And I believe the government paid, I think it was something like 100 million renminbi to make it or something.
Wow.
It's about 10 million quid. And shocking. This website, literally, you can't buy tickets unless you use it on Internet Explorer.
10 million for a non-browser compatible website.
Yeah, it's awful. And the train times are wrong, and you can only buy tickets using Internet Explorer. At the beginning, you can even use Apple computers.
Crazy, isn't it? And, and how's your Chinese? Are you fluent?
Yes, I am, yeah.
Could you say welcome to the Content Champion podcast in Chinese, please?
Oh, that's very on the spot, Loz. Content Champion podcast. 大家好,欢迎你们来内容营销podcast.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Richard.
Yeah, okay.
So you went to China, didn't you, on an exchange as a student, and you loved it, and you just wanted to go back. Is that right?
I went to as part of my university course. Yeah, and loved it so much that I thought I couldn't leave. But yeah, it's a brilliant country. I love it. But I'm actually taking a break from it. Next week, I'm flying back to the UK. I'm going to move to France for a bit just to have better internet and try and make Clamber an authority site. I mean, what I want it to be. Because there is a big problem with the internet over here, Loz. Like, it slows me down like crazy.
Well, touch wood. This is one of the best connections we've had, but I've got my fingers crossed for the rest of the podcast. So should we crack on with looking at our topic of today, which is how to make blog posts go viral? This is the 55 SEO experts reveal 3 favorite link building tools, isn't it?
Yeah.
Could you give us the URL for this particular post and give us a sense of what sort of success it's had to date in terms of social shares, traffic, inbound links that it's attracted, etc.?
Well, the URL is clamber.com/link building tools. So far to date, it has had 267 tweets, over 2,000 Facebook likes, over 100 or so G+ shares. Before this blog post went live, Clamber was getting absolutely no traffic whatsoever. It was like about 12 visits a day since March. And then when this blog post went live on July the 24th, it literally did the entire kind of 4 months worth of traffic before it in just literally 2 days.
Right.
So all that culminated visits just in one go, bang. And it really did put the blog on the map. And since that blog post went live, Clamber's had over about 12,000 visits since then.
That's amazing. So there's lots of questions that come out of this that I'm sure everyone's thinking, you know, why, how, everything else like that. But I understand that you had a cunning plan. This is quite deliberate to get the post to have a lot of interest before you even published it. And this is what I really want to look at, the sort of meat of this whole podcast. You've got a post there that took the site from 12 visitors a day to tens of thousands, basically. So what was your thinking behind it before you set out to produce the content?
Basically, before I did it, Clamber was going nowhere, and I thought, hell, I've got to do something that puts this blog on the map. Otherwise, it's going to go along unnoticed. I was trawling around for ideas, and I read a kind of like guide by Neil Patel and Brian Dean, and it talked about, you know, doing an expert roundup. And I thought, wait a minute, this is a great idea, because I have like no Twitter followers whatsoever. I only had 200 at the time. And I thought, well, if I can get experts involved and make something viral, then they'll help share, and then their followers will come, and, you know, I'll be able to reach out to so many people I wouldn't have been able to reach out to before.
Mm.
So I decided to do a roundup, and then it was a question of getting the right question. And because I'm an SEO newbie, I've been so frustrated with, you know, trying to find answers about what tools I should use. So this idea was actually already in my head for that. And then I thought, wait a minute, I could ask a question, you know, find out what tools the expert's using, and then I know what I want. And I thought other people would relate to this who are in the same position as me. So I came up with this question, and I thought, you know, ask for just three tools people use, because then it would get people to seriously think what they can live without and what they really need. I basically also realized that this question would also be able to be answered in one tweet as well, which really powerful stuff. So yes, I reached out to, in total, I think it was 115 people. And I was quite aggressive with my emails, but generally people replied really well. I mean, because the question was good. I was lucky because a lot of people did check out Clamber and they saw, I mean, nothing was going on, but they still replied, which was great. If people didn't reply, I jumped onto Twitter and tweeted at them directly. And I found that everyone replied on Twitter, which was amazing. I tried direct messages at first, but I realized no one replies to those. I just tweeted at people directly. I worked out when they were all online and, you know, active, and then tried to do it after they'd just done a tweet or whatever. Before the blog post went live, the way I got all the contributors excited about it was about half an hour before I launched the blog post, I did a kind of teaser one saying about how the roundup had gone, and the post was going to go live in 30 minutes, and then the results was really exciting. So I emailed all the contributors about half an hour before I was going to release a post to kind of tease them a little and get them excited. And I think this had a great effect because I got like 15 emails immediately back and people were excited. And then, yeah, half an hour later, when the post went live, I then emailed them again and I asked them to help tweet it because I couldn't get online because of the great firewall. They were really cool. Like, so as soon as I did that, everyone tweeted it. I also told Buzzstream, who turned out to be, you know, everyone's favorite link building tool, asked them to help promote it, and they did that as well. There was one really annoying thing that happened, which I actually submitted the post inbound, but shortly after, even after it got about 16 upvotes within a very, very short space of time, it mysteriously disappeared. So since then, I've learned that you should always, you know, have a friend to add your posts on inbound if you don't already have a profile on there. Luckily, someone else resubmitted it, and it did really well on inbound. It was pretty much at the top for a long time on there. So that got a lot of traffic. But yes, I mean, I think the reason why it got so much exposure on Twitter and Facebook was because I warned people and really made sure they were going to tweet it and everything.
So this is a whole strategy of outreach, really. It's creative thinking. It's looking at who are the influencers in your industry, thinking up a really sharp, short question that's valuable that you can ask them, that they're going to give you a quick answer to, but that's going to have some value in it. And then really quite aggressively following up on that and then promoting it afterwards. So it's quite a lot of work, but it's got great results.
Yes, and Loz, I'll get to the I'll tell you what my cunning part of the plan was. Right from the very beginning, I wanted to use Brian Dean and Neil Patel's strategy for one reason, really. I wanted to prove that it worked.
Okay.
I wanted to use an expert strategy who I knew had a lot of followers and a lot of exposure. I wanted to try one of their techniques and then prove that a newbie blogger could transform their blog into, you know, a kind of unknown, invisible entity, and then suddenly transform it into something, you know, put it on the map overnight.
Fantastic. You know what I mean? Fantastic.
So I thought, let's try Brian Dean's strategy. But my ultimate goal was, after a couple of weeks or so, to either get a guest post on Backlinko or for either Neil or Brian to write about it. Yeah, shortly after the post went live and then after it had such success, I then emailed Brian and I said, hey, mate, you know, I actually used your strategy to do this post and I'd love to write a guest post on Backlinko about it because I got some amazing results and it's transformed the blog overnight, obviously. And then, yeah, Brian was awesome and he said he'd do a case study on it. And then I did a lot of link building and then he wrote this really cool case study showing how the results worked. And then, of course, you know, I got a lot of exposure from Backlinko. And his followers came along and checked out Clamber.
Like me?
And that was the end, really. Yeah, to get exposure then from Backlinko after kind of everything cooled down a little bit. Yeah, so that was the kind of cunning plan, and it paid off, and it got a lot of traffic and a lot of new followers and comments and everything.
The great thing about this is, though, is that it's not just links. It seems that this type of content marketing, outreach, inbound link building, it really attracts engagement that's valuable, doesn't it? I mean, these are like myself. This is how what you've described is exactly how I found you and your blog. So this stuff really gets real targeted interest in your site. It's not just like in the old days where you'd throw a few crappy links at your site and hope it would get rankings and then hope someone would click on your position in Google or whatever. We're talking about real connections, yeah, aren't we, through link outreach?
Yeah, it's a totally different ballgame now, isn't it, of course? I believe this is the way to go now. I mean, just try and create some really crazy, amazing content. Get exposure from these kind of methods rather than spending ages building links. I mean, once it's out there and you've pushed it out there, then people come to it and then they'll link to it.
And you've got other strategies as well, haven't you? You've used images. There's a great post on the blog about the images that you use in link outreach and particularly broken link building. How does that work?
I was having a little difficulty getting responses for some of my link outreach, and I thought, hell, let's try and make it a bit more personal. So I made some kind of funny image with each blogger's name imprinted on an image of some Totoros shouting on the top of a hill, the blogger's name in exclamation marks. So it's kind of funny. It's from the movie My Neighbor Totoro.
Yeah, it's a great film. My kids love that film.
Yeah, and I thought, yeah, try and use images, you know, to get the blogger's attention. So, yeah, I experimented with that, and it got quite a few replies. But, so I've been tweaking it recently, Loz, and now I'm just using one image each time. In my first beta email, I was using three images. But now, sometimes, yeah, I just use one image with the blogger's name and a shorter thing under it. Just say, you've got a broken link on your site. Are you still updating? Would you like me to fix it for you or something? But before I was sending a lot of text underneath the image, but now I just literally just send the image and say underneath, are you still updating blah, 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 .com? I notice a broken link and then bang, just like that. Mm. And I find that's quite effective. But before when I sent this this image email, I made the mistake of actually fixing the link in the first email, which was really silly.
Right.
Because then people never replied, but they actually fixed the links. So I think it's always very important not to give anything away in the first email with broken link building like that.
So you were just being incredibly helpful for a few hours for everybody.
Yeah. I mean, honestly, man, one blog I actually fixed. I don't know what was running through my mind at the time, but it was maybe a bit of OCD. But I fixed like 115 links on one page.
Wow, they must have been pleased. They fired their web development team and you did it all for free and didn't get one backlink.
Yeah, and he didn't even reply to me as well. And I sent an email like a day later saying, yeah, you're welcome, mate. Like,
but this is the thing.
It took me ages.
The thing about it is, though, is that it's the creativity, it seems to me. You're obviously an expert in this. You've only been doing it for 6 months, and that's because you're really creative in the way that you're putting yourself out there. You're sort of using these strategies, you know, in with some lateral thinking. You know, sometimes they don't work. Not everything's going to work. But when it does work, the response rates are really good, aren't they, from this type of approach?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. And I seriously believe now my new strategies for link building are basically I'm putting it on two very, very separate extremes. Okay. So I think you should never do it in between. Either the first extreme is keeping it very simple and just very quick and just saying, you've got a broken link, like that. And then the other extreme is going super duper personal. But in personal, I mean making a video for the blogger. You know, making a personal video saying, hey mate, and being very funny in it if you can, and saying, yeah, I've noticed this page, blah, 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 or this is my story, and have some funny, you may wear something silly in the video or whatever. But I don't believe in doing anything in between, as in writing a long email where you've kind of looked at the blog, you've found a question you want to say about someone's post or whatever, and then, you know, spending like 10 or 15 minutes over an email, because I find that no one responds to those emails, you know, but respond to videos. Now I keep these things very separate, so it's two extremes, either a very quick email or an incredibly personalized video. Otherwise, the in-between kind of mishmash, I don't bother with anymore.
For link outreach and for, you know, finding people in your niche who are authorities for roundup posts and for finding broken links, for broken link building, there are a couple of great tools that you mentioned on Clamber. What exactly are those and how are you using them?
Okay, yeah, the tools I use every day are Buzzstream and Check My Links. Just those two. And Open Site Explorer as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I love broken link building. And I think, in the SEO niche, it's pretty much the only way to go. And it has great results. So, yeah, what I generally do is I'll either use Open Site Explorer and get the top 10 competitors and bung them in there and then find who's linking to them. Or I'll just type in a few, you know, advanced Google searches to find out, you know, who's writing about this subject. And then I'll trawl through all those pages after putting them into an Excel to check out, you know, which ones are broken links. And this Check My Links plugin, you literally just open up the page, click it, and it goes through and shows you if there are any, you know, broken links by highlighting them in red and puts a little 404 next to them.
Mm.
And then what I'll do, if I find broken links, I'll then put all of the contact details into an Excel, which I separate into various fields that I can then upload to Buzzstream, which is, it's a kind of CRM for outreach, which I use every day. Yeah, so I'll upload all these contacts into Buzzstream, and then I'll literally just fire off a template I've already got saved on Buzzstream, which is very simple. It simply says, like, hey, blogger name, are you still updating blahblahblah.com? I found a broken link I'd like to point out. Just that. So then I can just very quickly go through each contact and then send off that email in bulk. I don't do any fixing for them at that first stage. If they reply back, then I've got their broken link page already logged in my Excel, and then I can go back and then fix it later, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But I do this process every day. I check, you know, who's replying on Buzzstream. And then also, once you get the link, you can log it into Buzzstream. Mm. Rather than putting it in an Excel, you log it into Buzzstream and just note down who's given you a link. And then you can check later to see if that link's, you know, gone or whatever.
In terms of the exact process, you've just written a post about blue widgets, okay? And it's fantastic, high quality content, et cetera, et cetera. You go into Google and find the top 10 ranking sites with authority about that particular topic you've written about. You back engineer their links through like Majestic SEO or Open Site Explorer. And then you go to all those sites who've linked into similar content and you find broken links on the page and then go through the process you're describing. Is that roughly it?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's roughly it. But then if they don't have any broken links on their pages, usually if it's got no PR, then I'll just delete it and won't bother. But if there are some pages which are pretty cool, you know, it's got like PR3 or above or whatever, then I'll highlight those in a separate, bung them in a separate Excel, and then I'll make them a funny video.
Right.
Yes. But this is something I've only just started trying, Loz, and I'm going to report on it possibly in 2 weeks' time after I get back to the UK. But yeah, I find with ones that I still really want to link on, but I've got no other way in, like no foot in the door.
Yeah.
I think the best way is to make something utterly personal and hilarious. Because, I mean, who seriously is going to want to, like, fire up their blog's back end, go in and, like, hunt around for that page, which maybe was written back in 2007, and go in and help some guy out to, you know, add a link for him, if you've literally given him nothing in return? I mean, I think that even writing a nice email complimenting their blog and everything, in certain industries like SEO and all this, you have to do something a little bit out of the box. So I do think that if you really want to land a link on a page like that, you've got to either have the most epic piece of content that it kind of stands out, or, you know, go that one step further and make something really personal for them. If someone said to me, yeah, like, can you add a link on your page? I'd be like, no, mate, you know, you can't. If you just email me, then it's not cool. You got to kind of make me really want to go in and add that link, right?
So what do you do if they're not that technical? Because after all, not every site owner will know exactly how to fix a broken link, perhaps.
I usually will make a very, very detailed email telling them not just that the name of the broken link or which one it is. I'll usually provide very detailed screenshots with sometimes arrows or notes showing them where the link is on the page. And sometimes if, for example, you know, a lot of people, they write lists, yeah, like 100 best resources. And sometimes you'll find 4 broken links on that page. Now, it's not very helpful to go in and say, you know, tell them there's 4 broken links and say, would you mind replacing one with my piece of content? That means the blogger still has to find 3 other alternatives for the other 3 broken links. And that's going to take time. And, you know, they might not necessarily get round to it or forget about it because, you know, they've got to then go and search for other pieces of content. So the best thing to do is if you find a page you really want to link on that's also got other broken links, is to find useful replacements for them as well. And say to the blogger, like, yeah, I found 3 great resources, one from maybe Search Engine Land or from Moz. And then how about you replace the other one with the link I've done on my website as I've helped you out? And that gets a really good response rate.
This is amazing. This is actually Google changing an algorithm that's made humans behave in a way that is sort of, they're reciprocating help for each other on their own website. So we're actually making their websites better, as well as producing great content and helping them to produce great content as well and fix things on their site. So it's kind of a win-win all round, isn't it, this?
Yes, yeah, it is. Yeah, yeah, definitely.
You're listening to the Content Champion Podcast, showcasing high-quality content across the web.
We're back with Richard Marriott from clamber.com. You said you wanted to prove if Brian Dean's and Neil Patel's strategies worked, and they obviously did. You were 6 months in to a site, well, 2 months in at that point to a new site. Really, anyone can do the strategies that you're talking about, can't they?
Yes, indeed. I'll tell you now, Loz, actually, in a couple of weeks when I move to France, I'm going to be building a new authority site with my brother. And it's in an industry which has a lot of experts and a lot of people following those experts. And I'm going to do expert roundups to start off exactly the same thing, because I think it's a really great foot in the door and it's a good way to get traffic and immediately put your blog on the map. I mean, I think anyone can copy this strategy, and there's always going to be experts in any industry. I mean, for example, if you want to do like a recipe site, you know, hit up a load of chefs. There's loads of chefs on the internet, right? And ask them a question like, if you could only eat one dessert for the rest of your life, what would it be and how would you make it? And then, I mean, you'd get like maybe 50 expert chefs all give you their best ever recipes, right? And that kind of stuff is really viral. Or like a fitness site, you could ask a load of bodybuilding experts just to tell you their favorite recipe for like a protein shake. So what do you blend? Do you put some almonds in it or some spinach or whatever, and get loads of recipes from like bodybuilders or whatever. Strategy you can copy to anything. And it's really, yeah, it's very powerful.
I can see why you're good at this. If you're in the if you're in those two niches that Richard's just mentioned, I'd go and do those two roundup posts right now and get ahead of whoever else is listening, because they're two really good ideas. Now, look, okay, we're really saying then, given all these Google changes and all the various penalties, we all know about these now, the right content production strategy going forward is to produce a mind-blowing piece of content, even if you just do one a month. That's absolutely fantastic, and then use all these strategies to really promote the hell out of them to get some traction and get some actual eyeballs on your site.
Yes, definitely. I seriously think the internet has enough of all these how-to guides and regurgitated things of other people's content. I think it's just the same old crap again and again. So, I mean, instead of focusing on, oh crap, I've got to write a blog post this week, or I've got to write 2 a week because you've got to keep blogging. That's what everyone says. But the problem is, if you're only spending a couple of days on something or one day, then it's not going to be epic. I mean, unless you literally hit gold or whatever. So I seriously think the best strategy these days, especially with how Google's changing, is to spend, you know, 2 weeks or even a month on creating a piece of content. And think of it like you're writing a university dissertation and you've got your professor breathing down your neck, and think that it's the most important piece of content, you know, in your life each time, and it's going to get graded and critiqued. That way, I think it's much more powerful. you're also more likely to rank for the keywords you're going after. Rather than 1,000 words, go for 8,000 words or 10,000 words. Just go for it. And yeah, I think this is definitely the way forward now. And also, if you spend more time over crafting that piece of content, it also allows you more time to think of the strategy on how you're going to market it. You can already schedule emails for people you're going to immediately tell about the content after it's released. You can build a huge list. For example, if it's taken you a month to put it together, over that month you can also build a list of people to reach out to, build a list of blogs that have got broken links you can immediately hit up. And also you can schedule emails for link building roundups and everything. And then when you know you release that amazing piece of content, not only is it going to like blow everything else out of the water, but also you've got a strong strategy for people seeing it and getting exposure and links to it. And then that's just going to have so much more of a powerful effect than if, for example, you just do, you know, a standard blog post and release it to your email subscription list. Yeah, it would do right. But if you want to do things cool, I think definitely taking the time over it's more important these days.
So really, we're all becoming content marketers. Each blog post that you do, the process you've described, is a sort of mini content marketing cycle of research, content production, outreach, and sort of promotion in a neat little cycle that if you complete, say, only 12 times once a month on your blog and really take time over it, you're going to have tons and tons of traffic, aren't you?
Yes, definitely. But one thing I must say, though, is that links, despite doing an amazing content strategy and reaching out to tell everyone about it, I still have to say that links are definitely very, very important. I've actually been doing a little bit of a test on my recent roundup. Okay. I did one local SEO around the world. And yes, I hit it hard with the content marketing. I got it on many weekly roundups, including search engine land. And then I just stopped everything. Right. And for 2 weeks, I haven't built a single link. I haven't done anything. And I've been keeping track of its position on Google. It kind of went up. It peaked on page 2 of Google. And on the smaller ones like google.co.uk or Australia and New Zealand, it got onto the first pages. But then gradually, it's been dropping. Right.
And okay.
And I seriously think now, and I've just started building links literally a couple of days ago, I'm going to try, Loz, to kind of prove a point that you still need links. Mm. I mean, I don't know whether it's going to work out or not, but now I'm building links after kind of, you know, the heat cooled off. And I'm going to see if you still do need links and everything, and if that will push it up onto the first page of Google. But this is kind of a test, like in progress, and I'll report on that. But I still think definitely links are important, especially broken link building or whatever. And hopefully we'll see if that works, and then I'll tell you guys about it in, I guess, 2 weeks or so.
Fantastic. Well, that's an exclusive that we've got on the Content Champion podcast. So really, we're looking at the perfect strategy. Probably your findings will probably bear out that the perfect strategy is our per post content marketing outreach strategy combined with some good old fashioned but very high quality link building using reverse engineering tactics and broken link building and stuff like that. So you probably don't have to get many links, I shouldn't imagine, to a piece of content that's got as much initial buzz as your 55 SEO experts post. You're probably only going to have to get, you know, Brian Dean in the last podcast was talking about 10, 20 really high quality, niche specific, high authority links to a post like that. And it should stick around in the SERPs for ages.
Yeah, I think you're right, Loz. Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that's definitely the aim. I mean, just get the high quality links on some good PR3, whatever pages, PR3 and above. And yeah, the people I'm reaching out to now, they've all written about local SEO for this one. And yeah, we'll see what happens with that. I'm not one of those guys who does just loads of blog comments or, you know, social bookmarking or whatever. I do believe, yeah, the most important thing is just get a few high quality links and it should pay off. So we'll see what happens, yeah.
Now, moving sideways slightly to look at Clamber's design, it's a very quick, light, easy to navigate site. I think it's running on thesis. And, you know, was this important to you when you started your blog to sort of present your content in the right way on fast loading pages that had a sort of really clean look? Was that something you looked at from the outset?
Yes, it was. Yeah. I don't know how I bumped into thesis, but I think it was a post someone wrote about how they changed the thesis. And then I realized the importance of page load speed. And also the fact you can, you know, go in behind and make it, you know, optimized for SEO by, you know, setting the meta tags as you want them and the title tags. So, yes, I chose thesis for this point. I'm actually still rocking the old version, which is the I think it's 1.85. Thesis has since upgraded to 2.0 or whatever, but I couldn't get to grips with that. It was confusing. But, yeah, actually, it was a bit... It's a bit frustrating, to be honest, Loz, because just as I built the blog on thesis, I suddenly realized that everyone had stopped loving thesis and they've all been talking about Genesis.
Content Champion runs on Genesis, but I was thinking of changing to thesis.
Oh, really? Yeah, I mean, I don't know what to do, to be honest. I mean, at the moment, it sounds like the new thesis is really good, actually. So I'm still stuck. The question is how to change it onto the new thesis or onto Genesis. But yeah, I chose thesis for the fact of it being fast and everything. But I'm going to look at Genesis and perhaps change it over the next few months when I can afford to, you know, pay a coder to make the change.
Okay, well, let's just take a step back then and look at some long view questions, some future trends, if you like, because obviously, you know, you've already become somewhat of an SEO expert. What do you see happening in the content marketing and SEO space over the next year or so? Is it just going to get harder and harder?
Yes, I think it's going to get a lot more competitive, and gradually people are going to realize that they need to make longer blog posts, and they're going to have to like pay more attention to quality in terms of that. So at the moment, I think it's quite easy to rank for competitive keywords just from going that extra mile rather than doing what every other blogger is doing and still thinking that 800 words is enough, you know. But also SEO, yes, it's getting a lot harder. And I think that Google are going to prefer tweets and G pluses and everything, definitely over links, for sure. I think links are going to get less valued, and social is going to get more important. For the link building tools post, actually, I only physically built less than a dozen links to that. And it's at the number one spot on Google. I guess it's because there was no content competing with it. But also it just shows the amount of social shares and everything, how even a blog with no PR, which Clamber has no PR still, and no authority, is still at the top of Google for that keyword when there's quite a bit of competition. And that shows that that social really has put it up there, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, but you know, you got a dozen high-quality links, and then I guess social shares and everything, when it gets to a certain volume, the attention that gets, that flags up with the algorithm, really says, okay, this is authority, trust this. And the links kick in as well, and the whole recipe is one for a high ranking.
Yes, exactly. So I definitely don't believe that you'd be able to get to the top of Google if you haven't got at least 100 social shares. I mean, even just 30 or whatever, I don't think it's going to cut it. So, yeah, if you want to really rank, if ranking is important to your blog, then for sure you've got to focus on making the content a lot better. Yeah, and then that's the right recipe. Make the content amazing, make it socially shareable, and then just a few powerful links will bump it up on Google for sure. To be honest, I think SEO is pretty easy, generally. It's still the same formula, but you just got to just focus on making everything you do just so much better than the competition, and it should do all right. You've 100% got to promote and got to build links. I mean, it's stupid to think that you're just going to rank or links will come naturally. It's not going to work like that unless you're an authority. One thing as well, I'd be very interested to know if Google has this as one of their algorithms. I'm not sure if you'd agree with this, Loz, but I'm wondering as well whether, you know, for example, you have an email subscription list, right? And every time you release a piece of content, you've got the same people tweeting it and G-plussing it, right? I mean, because they have a subscriber list. But I'm wondering if Google has an algorithm that notices that it's the same people promoting it and saying it's good, whereas sometimes it will also notice whether there are many more fresh people different to old people.
I think you're right. I think they do have.
Yeah.
Or they're working on it, because surely as well it would tie into the authority of the person tweeting.
Yes, it's great to post every week or so. You know your followers going to tweet out your stuff and everything. But Google may not be noticing that unless your stuff is so amazing that it goes extended beyond your own following and fresh people are tweeting it, and then fresher people with loads more followers are tweeting it. So I'm sure that's something that's playing a part in all this, and why people shouldn't be relying on their subscription lists and just churning out the same old regurgitated stuff every week because they know it will get tweeted. And I really hope that Google's doing that. I think it's good news for us guys who want to produce, sick-ass content or whatever.
So this actually dovetails quite neatly into my next question, from link building to list building. You mentioned, obviously sending emails out about your content to the same pool of people, and do they tweet it or whatever. Has your own list on Clamber been beneficial to creating a community and getting return visits? How's it working?
Yes, it has been pretty beneficial. I must admit, though, my list is very small, but it has been very beneficial in one aspect. It's driven me to know what I should be blogging about, because at the beginning I thought people were most interested in my kind of case studies, but actually they're more interested in the interviews. So at the beginning when I did Clamber, I thought, I'll just try out some new methods. Maybe I'll do someone's strategy on how to get more Twitter followers or whatever. But now I've realized that my subscribers, they really want more interviews. So I'm going to change Clamber now to just do, one big roundup every month. And then, a bit about link building and case studies on the side. But it's helped a lot in guiding me. My followers have also been tweeting a lot, and they've been awesome at jumping on the comments. And I love that. I think, lists are very important in that sense. And 22% of my blog's visitors are return visitors. But the one thing that's really, really grinding my gears is I really want to be able to put my email sign up, my AWeber sign up form at the bottom of every blog post. But I still haven't worked out how to code that in myself, because I'm missing out seriously. At the moment, my subscription box is only on in the sidebar, but I don't know how to hard code it into the bottom of every blog post. So I know I'm missing out on a serious amount of subscribers from that. So one of the first things I'm going to do when I get back to the UK is find someone to hopefully help me, hard code that in, because it's powerful stuff, right?
Yeah, actually, I can help with that. You should have a look at Hybrid Connect from Shane Malach, who I interviewed a while back on the podcast. It's a fantastic resource for list building, a plugin, and you can put all your opt-in boxes wherever you like. So I'll put a link to that underneath this podcast. Okay, so list building, a good thing in the overall strategy, because Brian Dean again was saying that it doesn't necessarily work in all niches, but I guess in the industries we're in, it does.
Yeah, it seems to, definitely.
So heading towards wrapping things up, I'd have to say to everyone that, obviously we've had a fantastic chat about everything to do with how to make blog posts go viral, looking at different types of broken link building, link outreach, some tools that we can use to do that, and some of your strategies behind it. So thank you for all your fantastic information and for your time today, Richard. Could you remind us where we can find you online? You've got the best About Us page I've ever read, by the way, on Clamber. It's fantastic. I feel I know you and your brother and all your history, and it's funny and engaging. So there's another lesson there about the importance of a good About Us page on your blog. But tell us where you are and where we can find you, and perhaps what you've got coming up in future.
Okay, yeah, great. I'm moving back to the UK very soon, in a week, and then I'm going to be moving to the Alps in France. Just for the fact of getting into the middle of nowhere, no distractions, so I can really knuckle down. I'm going to be usually hanging out on Twitter. My handle's @Clamber. Yeah, when I get back to the UK, hopefully I'll also be able to get on other social networks. At the moment, I'm not very active on G+. or Facebook simply from the fact I can't access them. But I'll definitely be a lot more social when back with a better internet connection. In the future, you'll definitely see some posts on Clamber about the new authority site I'm going to be building. Just before the Christmas period, I'm going to be bashing out a site in about 2 months and try to make that profitable. If that's not a massive success, and I'm not milking it online by then, I'll be looking for jobs in London, I guess, to work for hopefully an SEO agency. If anyone's interested in employing a link builder or a blogger, then yes, please do hit me up. And yes, that's generally what I'll be doing, Loz, I think.
Your blog is Clamber, that's CLAMBR.com. So it's Clamber without the E in it.
Yes, that's right, no E.
Fantastic. Go check it out, folks.
Wait for it, listeners. Here comes the PS question.
This is the part of the podcast I call the PS question. Richard, could you please share with us an advanced backlinking or content marketing strategy?
Okay, so first, when you're launching a big blog post, make sure you've got a huge list of people who already write about the subject to email immediately afterwards. You know, if you're doing a new subject each time, it doesn't matter if they're people you haven't connected with before. Just give them a very short email saying this is kick-ass and they'd love to see it. It will look awesome on their blog or whatever. It's not spam. Just one email once in a blue moon doesn't matter. And then make sure you always notify, if you're doing an expert roundup, to notify your contributors 30 minutes before the post with a teaser before it goes online. And then also hit up every single link roundup you can possibly get your hands on after you've released your post within a couple of hours. To make sure it's on their map, hit them up on Twitter, email, both ways. Also, if you're doing an expert roundup, which I specialize in and I recommend, make sure you list all of your contributors' peak tweeting times. So make sure you know when they're most active, and also note down who their friends are. So put that in an Excel, because then you can craft tweets to mention their friends as well and say, oh, recently I did a roundup with blah, 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 or something. Or you'd say, like, Frank and Dom share their amazing insights in this epic roundup and blah, blah, blah. Because then people will be more likely to retweet if it's when they're active, and also if their friends are involved. Because, you know, buddies like to share other buddies what they're doing online and with their followers. Also, yes, with obviously I mentioned before, but I'd love to recap on it. When you're doing outreach for link building, either keep it short and sweet to not waste time, because your time is very important. Broken link building is great for cut time management. It's fast, it's simple, and I believe it's the most powerful. Otherwise, if you want to be personal, don't waste your time writing emails. Instead, make a video. Make maybe 5 videos a day. You can use the same email script for each one. It's very easy to do. Another thing, if you really want to get old school, that I seriously recommend doing is phone people up as well. Phoning people up is awesome because, you know, it's the best way of selling and it's personal. These days, the web is getting way too unpersonal. I mean, yes, we socialize, we go on social networks, but sometimes you've got to get back into, you know, the old way of doing things. So if you're struggling to build links, then try to make a personal connection by actually calling someone up, because that's powerful stuff. And believe me, it works. I'll be sharing all this in a future blog post. Those are mainly my kind of main tips for content marketing and link building.
Well, folks, I challenge anyone to find a more valuable 2 minutes about content marketing and link building on any podcast anywhere. Richard, thank you very much indeed for all your time and for talking to us today. It's been fantastic.
No problem, Loz, and thanks so much for having me. It's been epic.
So there you are, guys. That was session 11 of the Content Champion podcast. Thanks so much to Richard Marriott from Clamber.com for a fantastic interview. Don't forget, you can still enter the Content Champion Awards with your best content marketing material at contentchampion.com/awards. You'll find this podcast on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and the BlackBerry Network. But until next time...
Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's the Content Champion.